I am delighted, I am rejoicing this morning to be able to speak on behalf of Case Thorp. My joy is probably exceeded only by that of his parents, Chuck and Julie, who are here, his wife Jody, his two boys, Brooks and Charles, his daughter Alexandra is at camp, but there's an entire entourage that has come to celebrate with Case. And as I think about Case, I think about Romans 12:2. That reminds us that we are to think about culture in a different way. We're not to be conformed to its patterns, but instead be transformed by the renewing of our mind. We tend to think about spiritual renewal as that which comes through the heart, but it's a twofold thing. It's not just heart, but it's also how we think. We are renewed through right doctrine, through good theology, and I think that is the hallmark of the gifts that Case Thorp brings to us. He has a wonderful ability to connect the dots between what we feel in our hearts as to the love of Christ, but also giving that deep foundational theological truth and teaching it and embedding it in the life of the church because of his love for people. He has done exceptional ministry at First Presbyterian Church of Orlando, looking at what is happening in the culture, what is changing, and then what are the innovative ideas as we think through that that can bring about a farther extension of the gospel. So as a denomination, as we come to a critical juncture in our history, as we are thinking about the ever-changing culture around us and what are the ways in the past that perhaps don't work anymore, how do we need to be innovative? How do we need to be creative to continue to extend the gospel to a culture that increasingly rejects it? Case Thorp is uniquely gifted in that, and I believe will do a tremendous job as our moderator. I will say this too, he's been with me for 14 years. And when you're with somebody for 14 years, there's a lot that you go through together. And I have seen him become what I consider to be the consummate pastor, teacher, theologian. He knows not just the victories and the successes and the way in which God blesses through them, but he knows the pains and the hardships of ministry. And I can tell you there's nobody that I would rather have in the foxhole with me in fighting the good fight of the gospel than Case Thorp. And I know that I speak on behalf of our entire session and our congregation in wholeheartedly bringing him before you and commending him to you as our next moderator. Thank you.
I'd like to entertain a motion that the nominations be closed. Seconded. Thank you. Are you ready to vote? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, nay. The motion carries. His name has been placed in nomination. All in favor of Case Thorp to serve as moderator of the 39th General Assembly, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Case Thorp has been elected moderator of the 39th General Assembly. You all are going to love. You all are going to love Case Thorp. I've enjoyed getting to know him on the national leadership team. You've heard about his qualifications and his work. I've visited the Thorps. We had a lovely time together. He and Jody and their children have such a warm and welcoming home. You are going to respect Case for his thoughtfulness, for his work ethic, for his kindness, and if you're fortunate, his hospitality. Case, would you please come forward? Could I also ask that Chuck Thorp, Case's father, will come forward? Mr. Thorp is going to pray for Case, and sons Charles and Brooks and Jody, would you please come forward? And also, would past EPC moderators come forward? Case, would you take a spot over here? I have questions for you, questions of installation. Do you, Case Thorp, accept the office of moderator of the 39th General Assembly of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church to which you have been called and elected? Do you accept the office?
I do.
Will you fulfill your office in obedience in Jesus Christ and under the leading of the Holy Spirit? Will you?
With Christ's help, I will.
Will you be faithful and earnest during your time of office to maintain the truths of the gospel and to seek to maintain the peace and purity and the unity of the church? Will you?
I will.
And will you seek to adorn the office of moderator with honor by your manner of life, and will you walk with humility and piety before the people of this denomination? Will you?
I will.
And now I have questions for our assembly. Do you, the members of this assembly, promise to give Case Thorp as your moderator that encouragement in his labors, those prayers needed for his time of service, and to give him that honor and submission due the high office to which you have called him? Do you? Would all of the previous moderators, you've come forward. We're going to pray now. Chuck Thorp, would you do us the honor of praying for Case?
Dear Lord, we thank you for this day and our witness to the investiture of the Reverend Case Thorp as the 39th moderator of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. We ask that the presence, power, and peace that comes with our relationship with Jesus Christ be with us here today in this house of worship. Our prayer today is for Case as he lays these things at your feet, that he and Jody and their children worship you as Lord in their lives. That the First Presbyterian Church of Orlando continue to be in prayer for his work as the EPC moderator. That his life will be covered on being Presbyterian, Reformed, Evangelical, and missional. And that the churches of the EPC will daily pray for him as moderator and for the EPC leadership. Lord, we are reminded of Luke 9:23 when you said that if anyone will come after me, they must deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. Spirit of the living God, we ask you to fall afresh on us. Help us to live, work, pray, and sing in our lives of your glory. Empty our hands that we may receive as well as give. Open our ears that we may hear as well as speak. And enter our hearts as we truly love as well as serve you. With Case as moderator, may he grow in wisdom. As together we grow in faith, we ask that in this world we may praise you and live and be guided by your spirit and refreshed by your truth. Triune God, to you be the glory and the praise for now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Case, we now do the transfer of the bling. First, the stole of the moderator. The stole, I understand, has mixed traditions. The stole has been used by shepherds in the early years of the church, and it also marks the kind of uniform that was worn by Roman soldiers. And it's appropriate because you are both the shepherd of the church and its defender. And now, the cross of the moderator. On this cross are not only symbols of our Christian faith, but it also carries the central theme of all we do as a denomination, all we believe, truth in love. So as I pass this cross to you as a symbol of your office, always remember that we stand above all else for truth, yet, because the cross supremely represents God's love for us, remember that we hold the truth of God in love. May you wear this moderator's cross with humility and honor it with your life. Can we please welcome Case to service?
Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, bless us Goonies. Be with us in this meeting. Be with me in this leadership role. In Christ's name, amen. In September of 1866, my great-great-grandfather, the Reverend Charles Thorp, left the little village of Noak in Oxfordshire, England, to be a missionary for the Church of England, first in Canada, and then in the American frontier. Now, the record shows in his life he encountered tremendous difficulty and a lot of challenges, a lot of setbacks. Charles lost the companionship of his beloved older brother, who took off for the Australian Gold Rush of 1851, never to be heard from again. He and his young wife found their firstborn child and Charles' namesake dead in the family cistern that someone had tragically left open. Years later, his wife, after bearing five more children, sadly died and left him alone to raise the children. Yet in spite of these setbacks, the record also indicates that the Reverend Charles Thorp never let it get in the way of spreading the gospel and building the church. Over the course of his career, he continued to raise those children. In total, raised 10 children, for he married another woman, a parishioner at his church in Tampa, and interestingly, he did her father's funeral about 4 months before their marriage. Wouldn't you love to know that story? But he served on the wooded frontiers of Jacksonport, Wisconsin, Tampa, Florida, Mansfield, Louisiana, and the records show that over the course of his career, he never made more than $800 in a year. How much is your hotel bill going to be this week? He got 2 days vacation right after Christmas, 2 days off per year, 2 Sundays off, only to go do more mission work. As a woman at the Tampa church writes in a letter, he was described as the indefatigable missionary, never letting the gospel down. Well, 115 years later, after he set out from Noak, and just 38 years prior to us today, Bart Hess, Andy Jumper locked arms with Ed Davis, George Scotchmer, Jim Van Dyke, and launched out on their own journey. They dared to explore where Christ Church could go and what Christ Church might look like, being fully evangelical and reformed. They and those of their era had to find a way to creatively administer in a time of challenge, change, and opportunity. They had seen the rise of evangelicalism in America. They had seen the civil rights movement reshape society for the better. They had seen the explosion, or the beginnings of it, of the global Southern church. They had also seen progressive theology undermine the truth of God's word and the uniqueness of the gospel, social revolutions and feminism and sexuality. Our founding fathers, and even some of you in this room here today, began this experiment that we know as the EPC in theology and polity and church culture and missional effectiveness. In fact, if any of you were here at that first EPC General Assembly in 1981, would you please stand right now? We Goonies, thank you. Thank you. Friends, the greatest generation is increasingly joining the great General Assembly in glory. Baby boomers retiring at the rate of 10,000 a day. I read recently that corporations are now predicting that within 5 years, 3/4 of their top leadership and management will no longer be in the workforce. Gen Xers and millennials increasingly find themselves taking the reins of leadership and yet presented with their own missional challenges and evangelistic opportunities. Adult conversions, friends, have bottomed out. And I don't think there's a person in this room that will find that acceptable. Our discipleship practices, well, we found over the last 25 years, haven't been so effective. Biblical illiteracy is a plague on today's church. Postmodernism is redefined the meaning of a man and a woman, even a child, an in utero child, such that our Christian anthropology is now a political threat to our neighbors. Pentecostal and non-denominational churches are giving us a run for our money with the masses, and yet introducing some interesting and concerning gospels, the prosperity gospel, starry-eyed pastors seeking fame and worshiptainment, unmoored from her historic roots. We're only beginning to taste and see the impact of technology and the impact of social networks on our politics, our economics, our interpersonal relationships, and on ministry. The challenges are great. But we're here. We're here because we know our God is sovereign. Amen? We are here because we know the gospel of Jesus Christ changes lives, changes communities, and brings about restoration. Amen? We are here because we know the Bible to be the truth, the story of God's mission to the world, and one that more and more need to know, especially our own. Friends, we are here because the words of our confession are true. The primary and highest purpose of human beings is to glorify God and enjoy in Him forever. We are here because, crazy us, we believe that a reformed, evangelical, missional, and Presbyterian church is the best expression of church in Scripture. Oh, we have challenges. If we didn't, we'd already be in the New Jerusalem. But these challenges, friends, are opportunities. And so I am honored to serve you, to stand here arm in arm with you, and to face the horizons, knowing we've got the Holy Spirit in our sails and Jesus calling us forward. Amen and amen.